and welcome to Tuesday Newsday, your number one resource for the entire week's worth of VR news. We've got new headsets, sick haptic and force feedback gloves, insane new motion displays with dynamic field of view. CES has started, and this means that we get to see a sneak peek into the future of VR. I'll be talking about everything relevant to AR/VR that gets announced at the event both this week and next, but we've got other things to cover too, so let's just rapid fire and get right into the news. Medal of Honor has received a few new updates that might change your mind about it a little bit. The most recent update gives the game a realistic scope video setting, which if you've ever played Medal of Honor, the previous scopes would do this weird thing where it takes your entire field of view when you look down them, and it was really weird, but it's fixed now. Scopes can be used like actual scopes. Additionally, there was some minor improvements to performance, but if you're looking for a really good World War II VR experience, Pavlov just got a huge update, and it's really, really good. 18 new guns, new character models, and crazily, freaking tanks. So now there's multiplayer tanks, and I'm not gonna lie, it's a blast. For a free update, it's pretty crazy, and you gotta give it a shot. One more thing before the CES coverage. Holy cow, the Quest 2 is absolutely popping off. It looks like all the marketing and advertising and everything else has been worth it, because just 7 weeks after the Quest 2's launch, the headset has surpassed both the original Quest monthly active users and the original Quest all-time peak of monthly users. To give you a quick idea here, the Quest 2 has beat the Quest's original numbers in almost every way after just 7 weeks, and the Quest has been available since March of 2019. I think that speaks for itself at the moment. I do worry a little that this massive jump in Quest 2 users will overwhelmingly influence the development of VR software in the near future to be biased for the Quest store. It just seems like you could make a lot more money faster on that store at the moment, but we'll have to wait and see. Now, finally, CES coverage. In case you don't know, CES is a giant trade show called the Consumer Electronics Show. Usually the event takes place in Las Vegas, Nevada, and it's where just about every tech-related company shows off their plans and devices for the next year or coming years. And every year I've been able to see AR and VR grow massively at these events. More companies, more innovation, and this year is no different. Unfortunately, one thing that is different is CES is completely digital, which makes sense. So, things that have caught my eye this year, at least so far. I have to start with these gloves. This is the Sense Glove Nova, and it's a dream of mine that one day, maybe soon, we can finally ditch having to use controllers in VR. I mean, just imagine the difference in immersion. If the gloves have force feedback, for example, your fingers would feel resistance of items within the game. A Dutch startup, Sense Glove, has announced a set of VR-tracked gloves that offer haptic feedback and finger tracking, and the most exciting part is, like I said earlier, force feedback. And it does it in a very interesting way. The strings attach the glove on each finger, and it has a friction brake on each string, allowing each brake or finger to provide 20 newtons of force. This allows you to essentially feel different shapes and textures in VR. If you're holding a ball, the glove will pull your fingers back according to the geometry of that ball. It's like reverse holding of objects, sort of. It's super cool, and the Sense Glove's method of force feedback is sleek as well, with the idea being to mimic the system of tendons within your hand. Of course, there's also haptic feedback in the glove, and it's compatible with any standalone VR headset apparently, which makes me wonder what tracking method is actually being used here. The older development kit had Vive Tracker compatibility, but I don't really see that here. In terms of availability and usage, this is obviously not for regular consumers. Costing a sleek $5,000, it's really made for professionals in a training environment. And even though that price sounds like a lot, the gloves provide one of the cheapest, most versatile options, leading to an active partnership with companies like Volkswagen. Now let's be real, this doesn't cost $5,000 to manufacture, so we may see something like this trickle down in the future. Either way, very cool. I always like talking about glove stuff here. Next up in the CES coverage is an extremely cool new kind of display for VR and mixed reality. One of the hardest things to do right now in a mixed reality pass-through setting is accurately capture the lighting of the pass-through and, of course, depth. Well, a company called C-Real has announced two prototype headsets that use something called a light field display. Now, how it exactly works is decently complicated, but the end result is a display that provides a light accurate pass-through image, but more importantly, allows for true-to-life depth to be seen in 3D, mimicking the actual eye. I'll try and put this really simply. Most VR headset displays basically use stereoscopy to achieve a 3D image, and this does the job for the most part, but it's only accommodating for one of the two two functions that our eyes use together to achieve a perceived depth. The new light field displays that are being used here allow for the usage of both, the stereoscopy type called convergence, or the image each eye is seeing combined together, and the second piece of the puzzle being accommodation, which is the change of focus in each eye independently. Normally, these two work together and gives reality its distinct three-dimensional look, but achieving that look in a headset is significantly harder. You could go down the route of the expensive varifocal displays that Oculus uses in their half-dome prototype, or you could use something like light field displays. Right now, field of view, resolution, and tracking methods are pretty interesting. The SeaRail headset uses a central light field display that is only 1000 by 1000 and only covers 30 degrees, and a more typical 1600 by 1400 display behind it. But you can see here in this through the lens video what kind of effect it has, and it's pretty insane. And here is that same technology but on an augmented reality headset. Having a pretty limited field of view of only 60 degrees, but objects having perfect depth is impressive. The more important thing here is that these headsets aren't actually available for purchase. They're sent out as evaluation prototypes so that this company can sell their light field technology to other headset manufacturers, which is an interesting business strategy and means that we may start to see this technology being infused with headsets in the future from all sorts of manufacturers. Already receiving $7 million in funding during its last round of investments, SeaRail is definitely a company that I've got my eyes on, and a lot of others do. Last year at CES, one of the coolest looking VR devices came in the form of Panasonic VR glasses. And yeah, these are VR glasses, or maybe even goggles, not technically a headset. Of course, the old version looked really cool, obviously going for a sweet cyberpunky look. And even sweeter are the extremely high resolution 2.6K micro OLEDs, which supposedly have the highest fidelity number ever achieved on a display of its type and offers 120 Hz operation and should be available soon to, quote, select partners, end quote, later this year. And I should also mention that this is far closer to a VR viewer than a functional VR headset like the Quest 2. Considering the display technology, form factor, and everything else, they look really sweet. Nolo, the company that makes a six-stop tracking method that actually a lot of VR headsets use, especially some cheaper Chinese VR headsets, has announced that they're making their own standalone VR headset with an interesting name, being called, right now at least, the six-stop inside-out all-in-one VR headset. Maybe that's not a final name, but it definitely is descriptive, I suppose. The headset specs aren't quite out yet, but it is going to be using Nolo's ultrasonic tracking for the controllers alongside camera slam tracking like what was used for most other inside-out tracked headsets. Honestly, I'm all down for whatever competition any company can throw at Facebook and the Quest 2, because right now, they have 100% market dominance, and that makes me very uncomfortable. This year at CES, we're seeing lots of smart glass AR technology, like the Vuzix smart glasses, which look sweet, but they're closer to a Google Glass, that being a heads-up display that just shows you things within your vision, rather than full-up augmented reality glasses that use spatial tracking. An exception to this is the Lenovo Think Reality A3, that I really want to get my hands on and try using for productivity applications. And here's what I mean by that. One of the marketing bits Lenovo mentions here is being able to use 5 displays at the same time, which sounds ridiculously cool. Imagine in the future just having to throw on a set of glasses and have unlimited displays and display size wherever you want in your room, or of course this is still pretty limited at only 1080p displays and we don't know the price yet, but devices like this are something that I'm extremely interested in. One thing I think of right off the bat is using this with a laptop while traveling. If you remember traveling, that is. I hate going from big desktop displays to a small 15.6 inch display while I'm on the go. Something like this could revolutionize that sort of mobile workflow. For a long time, Samsung has had a few VR prototypes that have been leaked or rumored, and it looks like we got another big leak, and it's interesting as well. Just look at this tracking ring. The idea is that you put your whole hand through the tracking ring. This may go along with the long rumored headset from Samsung that has the bug eye look, but there's no concrete mention of it here. Something a little more off-putting for me though is the lack of actual face buttons on the controllers, opting for thumbsticks but a trackpad instead of buttons. Not sure about this leak, but it does look interesting. One of my favorite YouTube channels of all time, DefunctLan, is actually launching a VR experience and it sounds awesome. It's kind of funny when a channel that I love and probably watch just about every upload from starts making VR content. I don't know, it just makes me feel warm and fuzzy. And the premise of this project is amazing. The channel focuses on dead or defunct amusement parks or other entertainment places from the past. And DefunctLan VR brings entire rides or areas that are defunct. Like for example, this recreation of a 70s Disney ride named 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, with almost almost every detail meticulously recreated virtually, and you get to actually ride the ride. A free alpha is available, and it's really cool. I urge you to check it out. But now it's time for question of the week from Ivan Morris. Do you think Oculus will remove the stupid Facebook requirement from the Quest 2? And it doesn't look like it. John Carmack recently completely shot that idea down, saying, quote, "Facebook login isn't going away. Given the climate, I don't expect people to believe it, but Facebook is extremely serious about its privacy," end quote. So, I mean, there's John Carmack himself saying no. If you've been hoping for it, it's just not gonna happen anytime soon, unfortunately. Make sure to leave your own questions below. I may just answer yours next. I will be streaming on Twitch today after this video, so stop on by and say what's up. Also, the Quest 2 giveaway will be happening soon on my Discord, which you still have time for. All you have to do is leave a comment on this video answering why you love VR, and screenshot it and post that screenshot to the Quest 2 giveaway channel in my Discord. I do want to thank all of my Patreon supporters, especially my Omegas like Benji, Biz, Caution Ramen, CPCJ79, Debonair Fab, Furtrap, Fusion Oak, HCG Randon, KR, Moyasu Entertainment, That Brock Guy, Tom, Very Evil Shadow, Zolnir, and I'm Naku. I couldn't do any of this without you. Don't forget to like this video if you loved it, subscribe if you want more of this, and hit that freaking bell if you just can't live without it. Much love, thrill out.